write in online and tell us how many in your home, so that we will know what is the population of the country. And it was then, during the Quirinius time, he declared a census, and so everyone has returned back to their hometown. Unlike we, it is just like, you know, in biblical times, you know, they all have to go back to your hometown. But we don't have to. If you are born in Ipoh, you have to go back to Ipoh. If you are born in Penang, Penang, or Johor, Johor, but we don't have to. But in the biblical times, the word had just, they had to go back to their place to be registered. And so there was a lot of busyness of the census, and registration, taxation, travel, and also accommodation. And in that time, Jesus, our Savior, was born very silently in the midst of a frantic and a tired world. So we are today. Our world is full of frantic and is tired. It's stressed out in the midst of the pandemic, we all know. Political issues in countries that are affecting us. And we see a lot of other issues which is very frantic. And today, just like what during the days of Jesus were born, was similar to like what we are today. And still, we still do not have a time and place for Savior in our life. Now, we are living in a very pathetic time, and they are hostile towards our Savior in this time of Christmas. But let me tell you this. Though we have no longer room for the Lord in our life, in our home, in our Christmas celebration, the Lord our God has not abandoned His creation. He has not abandoned us. Though that we look forward to December the 25th, and we all look forward it. But here we see something very strange about the shepherds. When the announcements were made to the shepherds who were born, the Messiah, the Lord of all, they went through and they came to a place and they saw and they worshipped God and they worshipped Him. And two important things were said in an angelic choir that we read in verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men, with whom He is well pleased. So we see the shepherds who came by and saw what has happened, and they see how God sort of reconciled with men. And we used to sing the famous caroling song, which is said, "Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled." It's a beautiful song. It has a nutshell of the Christmas message in this song called the Hark the Herald Angels, where it says, "Glory to the newborn King, peace on earth, and mercy and mild, and God and sinners reconciled." This is a time of reconciliation. This is a time that we need to come together. It's a time, friends, that Christmas is an important event that we need to come together in reconciliation. The shepherds were the first visitors to the newborn. They were the first visitors to the newborn and his parents. They came to worship the Savior. They came to worship the Savior of the world, and they went back rejoicing. Last Sunday we saw the wise men came and they gave expensive gifts. Right? The first was gold. The second was frankincense, the third was myrrh. And all had a meaning. We saw the meaning. Alright, gold is fixed to a king. And frankincense fits to a deity. And myrrh for sacrifice and suffering. And it is all well planned and put. And we see they were rich, wise men. As I told you, there was never three wise men just because of three gifts. Huh? It could be because the word of God says wise men. It could be plenty, plural. Or it could be two, it could be four, it could be five, you wouldn't know. But the important thing, they came and worshipped. But the first visitors were these shepherds. And when they came and worshipped God, they went back rejoicing. The worthy that had been revealed to them, as also they are the first hand to see God, the Savior of creation. Friends, they will never be the same again. They were completely transformed shepherds. They left all their sheep. When they saw and heard the angelic message was given, they hasted, went and saw the baby. They worshipped. And then they came back rejoicing, and they were completely transformed people. And this is the what the message is about. And we see the situation in Luke chapter 2, verse 1, when the consensus was called. Joseph has to take Mary with him, and they had to go to Bethlehem. When they came to Bethlehem, because of the consensus, right, there were lots of people who were coming in, and they were taking, there were no rooms available. And every place that he went to, they said, no vacancy. Every place where they went to, there was no vacancies. There were no room. And I can imagine how Joseph could have been pleading to the managers of the inn to let them know Mary's condition, as the time of the birth was very close. And there were a very desperate need for a place. There was no room. Even he could have pleaded to the inn's manager that I have a wife that need to be given birth and is a time about birth. And so there was no room. And it was said that they were shown to a place called manger. The Bible call it manger. But simply it's a place where cattle's, sheep's stays. And the manger is a very fancy word. But the actual word is a trough. A trough means a place where they throw in the food, hay, for goats and cows to come and eat. And also to pour water, as the sheep to drink water. Sheep does not drink water in a running stream, because it's got a very feeble heart. They would not drink. They will come to the still water to drink. So the trough was the place where they put water, food for these animals. And Joseph, being a carpenter, he saw it was a place where he can put all the grass, the hay, and laid Jesus in that place. And the scripture tells us in verse 7 that he was wrapped around with a swaddling cloth. Why was it? For a newborn baby, they had to put a cloth like a bandage around to restrict the movement of the babies due to the insects around. The fleas and flies that was around. It was a very unhygienic place, smelly. That was a place where the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, was born, because there was no room for him. The future King of England, Prince Philip, when Diana was admitted in the hospital, there was a big paparazzi was waiting out there to find what baby was born so that they will make it known in the big pomp. Now the child was discharged, was brought to the Buckingham Palace, where we see the rumors being fumigated every day and attended by 6 doctors, 14 nurses at all times, because he's a future king. And the room is air-conditioned, temperature being controlled according to the baby's need, because he was a future king of England. And he was born in such a state. But Jesus was born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He was born in a place where there was no room. Friends, it is now 2,000 years later. Millions of people have no room for Jesus. Many of us, you know, we empathetically, enthusiastically, we bring Christmas season and we are keeping him out of our life. We have all these Christmas decorations, we have everything in there, but Jesus isn't there. Let us all turn to this book and we will see. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and I will dine with him and he with me. How true it is. The message to Laodicea was given very clearly. The Lord said, I will come and knock at the door. If anyone who hears my voice and hears me, if you open the door, I will come and dine with you and you with me. What a privilege would be. Today it's a similar situation. The Lord is outside our home in the celebration of our Christmas. He's not in there because we have no room for him. We are prepared with a lot of cakes, food, friends are going to come by, family reunion. We see all these things are coming by. But we see today there is no room for Jesus in our place. We celebrate for the sake of festivities, with all the pomp, with all the styles, because we have no room for Jesus. You know, we've been going around to some places, you will find the word Merry Xmas. Have you come across that? They have X cries out. All right, now you may say, Pastor, they've got theological meaning. Yeah, X is a Greek word. Yes, I do agree. I know Greek. All right? Greek X is CH. Okay? Men, Christos. But not laymen will know this. None of us will know this. But to a layman, your X cries out. All right? Today is Merry Xmas, not Merry Christmas. So we have X'd out Christ today, many of us. And what more? Look at Malaysia. When it comes to Deepavali, we wish them happy Deepavali. Am I right? When it comes to Chinese, Hong Yi Ha Choi. But when it comes to Christmas, season's greeting. Never a Merry Christmas. Alright? Many fail to know the reason of this season is Christ. And it becomes season greetings. That shows even after 2,000 years, people have not realized they have no room for Jesus. What a better time for us while we're in this church, that we can rededicate our life to Him and give our life to Him and receive Him as our Savior and have room in our heart. That will be the greatest gift that we can give. And that will be the greatest meaning that we can celebrate Christmas. Because this world has no room for Him. And said, even Christians who celebrate Christmas without Christ in their home, without Christ in the midst of them. I know of a home, a pastor in Sri Kambangan, and he has got a big house, a double story house, and he's got a number of rooms. Of course, not everybody can have that. He has dedicated one particular room, and that particular room, he calls it the Lord's room, where he had a table with a big Bible in it, and he's got a chair, and on the top of the chair is a crown. A place where the family could come together to pray, read the Word of God. A dedicated room. They have room for Jesus in their house. Of course, not many of us got a privilege to have a room dedicated for Him. But you can have a room in your heart. That's number one. Right? And having a home, having the Word of God written in the walls to walls, would be the much better things to do. Of course, the Christmas tree is one of the best. Why do we have Christmas tree? What is the meaning? When you go to the origination, you know, when you have a Christmas tree, it is always kept in a darker corner. The Indians, to take out the Indians out. It's not in a bright place like this. The reason why they keep it in a dark corner, the lights of that will shine with all the glittering lights to give meaning that Jesus is the light of this world. Amen. That He came to bring light into the darkness of this world. And that is Christmas is all about, my friend. And so Christmas is something that when we welcome Christ into our life, friend, all our troubles and all our problems will simply fade away. If only we have Jesus in our heart. If only we have a room for Him. And look at the situation Jesus, Joseph and Mary, they were frantic. They were frantically looking for a room. And everybody, despite, you know, there's no humanity. The manager couldn't see that she's due for time for to give a birth. That she needs a decent place to give birth. But they can say with a stone hearted, no one can see. And that's the world we are living in today. That's the word we are here today. There's no room for Jesus in our life. There's no room for Jesus in our home. It is all festival, just like another festival that we're celebrating. Friends, it's the time to think and take stock. Do we have room for Jesus is the question that we need to ask before we leave. Do we have room for Jesus if Jesus only to come? And I see a reading here. Have you got room for Jesus? You who bore your loads of sin, as He knocks and asks for admission, sinner, will you let Him come in? Simple as that, by C.S. Spurgeon who wrote this. Simple as that, would we able to bring Christ? Friend, let me make it clear. If Christ is kept on the outside, there is something wrong on the inside. If you have kept Christ outside of your life, there's something wrong within you. Let me tell you this. There would be no blessings of the Lord. You don't see anything that what you do for success. Because the Lord promised you that I'll make you a head, not a tail. I'll make you above, not underneath. So these are the promises of God, and yet we are not experiencing them. Why? Because we do not have Him in our life. He is outside. He's knocking in our door. He's knocking our heart's door. He's knocking, even in some churches, said to say, they are worshipping without Christ. Their worship is more like a showmanship. He's outside the door knocking, he wants to come in. But no one wants to open your door. Friends, this is time. This is the time that we need to take stock and ask ourselves, do we have Christ in our life? Do we have a room for Him? So that He can be able to remake our life and make our life success this day. And a time that is, if you only come to have Christ in your life, as the song that we sang, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, we can reconcile with God, we can reconcile with the person that we have not spoken for days and years. This is the best. Christmas is a time for reconciliation with family members that you have not been spoken to, or friends that you have spoken to, or in hostile that you are with. It's a time. We are not like any other festivals. This is unique. This is a unique festival that we can come together, that we can able to worship God, reconcile with one another, have a meaningful Christmas, having Christ in our life. How many of us we need to rededicate our life this day and have Christ in our life, have Christ in our heart, and Christ in our home, and you will see the blessings of our Father God. Let us all pray.